Hey guys, today we'll discuss about adrenergic antagonist. So we should understand the term antagonist itself first to understand what is adrenergic antagonist. So antagonist is nothing but any substance which will go and bind with the receptor and it will block the normal activity which is produced by a triggering of that receptor. For example, let's take we have one receptor which is named as alpha. So, if I stimulate this alpha receptor with some substance, it will produce some action, that is vasoconstriction, let's take. Right? While as antagonist is nothing but whenever this receptor is blocked with some substance and that vasoconstriction effect is not produced. So, adrenergic antagonist is nothing but now the substances which blocks the adrenoreceptor. So where does this adrenoreceptor operate? So where they are located? So they are located in the sympathetic nervous system of our body. They are working with sympathetic nervous system of our body. Right. So there are two types of adrenoreceptor. One is alpha adrenoreceptor. One is beta adrenoreceptor. So in this video, majorly I'll be focusing on alpha adrenoreceptor blockers. So these alpha adrenoreceptor are further divided into two groups, alpha 1 and alpha 2. So in this video, I'm not talking about beta adrenoreceptor. Let's remove this. Right. So let's see the location of the alpha 1. Alpha 1 receptors are located in the blood vessels. Right. Not only in the blood vessel, but also in the postsynaptic membrane of the sympathetic nervous system. Postsynaptic membrane. So I'll come back to it, what is postsynaptic membrane. But they are also located in the urinary bladder. Where exactly in the urinary bladder? That is in the sphincter of the urinary bladder. Urinary bladder sphincters. Okay. And these alpha 2 adrenoreceptor, while explaining the postsynaptic location, I'll explain where exactly the alpha 2 are located. So this synaptic thing will come back here. Let's take this nerve ending which is forming a synapse with the other nerve. Right? So this is a part of sympathetic nervous system which I'm talking here. So this is a postsynaptic membrane. Right? This is a presynaptic membrane. And here we have our synaptic left. Right? So these alpha 1 adrenoreceptors are somewhere here which are located on the postsynaptic membrane. When we are talking about alpha 2, alpha 2 is located over here, right? So whenever I stimulate this, whenever action potential comes here, it will stimulate the channels, calcium channels, whatever is there, and it will make neurotransmitter release, that is norepinephrine to be released. Norepinephrine will come and bind with the alpha 1 adrenoreceptor. This is alpha 1, this is alpha 2. So these alpha 1, when they are stimulated, it will produce some effect, that is vasoconstriction or blood vessel constriction. And in the urinary bladder as well, they will constrict the sphincter of the urinary bladder and it will make urination to be difficult when they are stimulated. So these norepinephrine, whatever is released, it will go and bind with alpha 1 as well as it will go and bind with alpha 2 also. Whenever it will bind with the alpha 2 receptor, it will send something like a negative feedback saying that don't produce any more norepinephrine. So whenever I stimulate the alpha 2 adrenoreceptor, there is no release of norepinephrine. So this alpha 2 stimulation or agonist activity is shown by a drug called clonidine. So why we are talking about clonidine here? Because one of the uses for the alpha 1 or alpha 2 blockers is the clonidine withdrawal reaction. Let me explain what exactly clonidine reaction here. Whenever I was using a clonidine, it was continuously stimulating alpha 2 receptors and there is no norepinephrine release. As a result of which, when there is no norepinephrine release, this postsynaptic membrane will produce more number of receptors. That is more number of alpha 1 receptors. When I stop using this clonidine, there is no negative feedback going and it will release more of norepinephrine. When more of norepinephrine is released, the patient will have increased blood pressure. Right? So, when I stop clonidine usage, it was causing me blood pressure. Right? So, this is clonidine reaction. Remember this. Right? So, now we will go to the drugs, what exactly working with the alpha 1, alpha 2, right? So we are, how many classes of drugs we can have? We can have a class of drugs which can block both alpha 1 and alpha 2. We can have a class of drugs which block only alpha 1, which block only alpha 2, right? So the drugs which block both alpha 1 and 2 is called as non-selective alpha blockers. They are called as what? Non-selective alpha blockers. So here, non-selective alpha blockers. So when I'm talking non-selective alpha blockers, we will have two groups of non-selective alpha blockers. One is, which is irreversible alpha blockers. The other one should be reversible alpha blocker. So irreversible alpha blocker include the drug called phenoxybenzamine. It is phenoxybenzamine. So this drug is used in a condition called pheochromocytoma. Where we use it? We use it in a condition called pheochromocytoma. So we should know what is pheochromocytoma. Pheochromocytoma is a tumor from the adrenal medulla which secretes increased level of catecholamines. So once I block irreversibly the adrenal receptor, what will happen? My body should synthesize new receptor to act with the catecholamine. So that is the use of the phenoxybenzamine. Whereas reversible alpha blocker include a drug called phentolamine. So this phentolamine is a reversible blocker, but which blocks both alpha 1 and alpha 2. So where we can use this drug? I earlier told you what is clonidine withdrawal. We use it in a condition called clonidine withdrawal. We also use it in a condition called cheese reaction. Cheese reaction is nothing but when a person ingests that food or a substance which containing high levels of tyramine, so that high levels of tyramine will cause the symptoms of elevated blood pressure. So we used to treat that reaction, that is called cheese reaction, which is caused by tyramine. Right. So these are the uses of the non-selective alpha blockers. So now we shall have two other groups, that is one, the drugs which blocks only alpha 1 receptor, the drugs which blocks only alpha 2 receptors. So we'll start with alpha 1 selective blockers. So alpha 1 selective blockers. So alpha 1 selective blockers, that includes the name, drugs names called as doxazosine, there is a drug called prazosin, alfuzosin. We have one more drug called as tamsulosin. So these three drugs are used in the treatment of hypertension. So let's come back to the story of tamsulosin here. So this alpha 1 receptor, whatever is present, they are subdivided into two groups. One is alpha 1a and alpha 1b, right? So these alpha 1b are located in the blood vessel, while as alpha 1a are located in the urinary bladder sphincters, right? So tamsulosin, what it will do, it will go and block the alpha 1a type. It will go and block the alpha 1a type. When alpha 1a type is blocked, there is no contraction of the sphincter and the person will be able to urinate more easily. So this use, we can use it in the condition called benign prostate hyperplasia. We can use tamsulosin in benign prostate hyperplasia. Why? Because it has only effect on the alpha 1a, but there is no effect on the alpha 1b, right? Whereas doxazosin, prazosin and alfuzosin, they have effect on both alpha 1a and alpha 1b. So where we can use these doxazosin, prazosin and alfuzosin, if a patient we have hypertension and benign prostate hyperplasia, we can use these group of drugs. While as a patient only with benign prostate hyperplasia, it is better to use tamsulosin, because if we use these group of drugs, it will cause hypotension, right? So this is a story of our alpha 1 blockers. Now let's discuss about alpha 2 blockers. Alpha 2 blockers has only one drug that is not actually used. Alpha 2 selective blocker has only one drug, which is called as yohimbine. Yohimbine is a drug which is derived from the tree called yohim tree, which was earlier used for the stimulation of sexual stimulation and other purposes, but it has no accurate activity, so this is not used these days. Now we have discussed about what are the uses and how they work, right? So this all alpha 1 blockers was causing vasodilation. Why vasodilation? Because stimulation of alpha 1 receptors will cause vasoconstriction, right? So we'll discuss the side effects. Side effects of alpha 1 blockers include, that is, they have one particular property that is called first dose effect. First dose effect. So this first dose effect is postural hypotension. Whenever we administer alpha 1 blockers to a person, they will produce this first dose effect, that is postural hypotension, because they will dilate both veins and arteries as well. So there is a decreased vascular resistance and they will cause decreased blood pressure, and the patient will suffer from a condition called first dose effect, that is postural hypotension. Apart from this, the patient can have sexual dysfunction. Headache, dizziness, and we can have other non-specific side effect, but one more specific side effect, that is retrograde ejaculation. So this retrograde ejaculation is caused due to the alpha 1 receptor, not only in the sphincter of the urinary bladder, but they are also present in the ducts which involve in the ejaculatory process. When those receptor alpha receptors also blocked, they will have a impaired contraction of the ducts which involve in the ejaculation, and they will cause retrograde ejaculation. So this is the story of our alpha blockers. So beta blockers I'll make in the part 2. Keep following. Thank you.